Yeah, my name is Roland Ortt. I'm an associate professor in Delft University of Technology, and I'm in the field of innovation management and entrepreneurship. Yeah, well, in a particular piece of research that I was very motivated to start doing was work on niche strategies of entrepreneurs, and just before large-scale diffusion. So how do entrepreneurs introduce their completely new, then in my case usually high-tech product or system, into the market, and what strategy do they adopt? Yeah, the reason I was interested in that area, in fact, is a combination. In fact, as an R&D manager before becoming an academic, I found out that it really takes a long time with a lot of failures before something hits the market. And the issue is that usually the first couple of failures seem to disappoint everybody, and then seems to imply that something will never be successful, which is a misjudgment in my opinion, because some of the most successful high-tech products, they failed for decades until they became a hit. So that sort of was my practical reason. And the other reason is curiosity. So why is that? What's happening in that period in between? I opted, in fact, it was a bit of an implicit choice to choose a particular method to do research on this topic, because as part of my PhD, before I went to industry, I sort of was interested in particular ICT cases and what the history was of those cases. And then I found this long period before they really became successful. So the failed attempts to introduce something that was called telephony, but was not telephony in the beginning. And so I studied a couple of those cases and I got interested. It became only the introduction of my PhD. And then after 8 years of industry, I sort of this interest was improved or increased. And then when I went to academia, I felt like, okay, now I'm going to find this out. And I continued with studying in detail historical cases. So my method is tracking historical cases of various industries to see contrasts, meaning that the phase of market formation for materials is a little bit different than for medicines. And it's interesting to see the contrast, because by looking at the contrast, you see the point. Well, what I found is, first of all, I found a lot of data that didn't make sense in terms of what you need to do. So I had piles of data. I have more than hundreds of cases that I studied in detail. And then I could sort of track exactly over time in how many niches new technologies were introduced or new high-tech products. But that didn't make sense in terms of what you have to do. It was only historically. So it took me really a while to translate that into, well, what happened actually is that a particular type of niche strategy was adopted. So I had to translate this pile of historical data into a set of, I ended up with 10 different niche strategies. And I had to translate the data about the market situation at that time into sort of a tool to characterize the market situation that made sense to choose one of those strategies. So in fact, there's two steps. There was a huge data gathering effort, which took me, well, about 10 years. You have the time as an academic. And then there was a sort of a desperate sense-making process of all that data. Yeah, well, what we found is that, for example, we found that, I think is quite interesting, there were 10 different niche strategies that are usually adopted, at least from the 100 cases that I investigated. Now, let's assume that's an almost complete set then. And in fact, if you go in the literature, there's only the saying, you need to introduce your technology in a niche strategy, but it's almost no information. So the distinguishing of those strategies was interesting, but what was, I have to say, I found myself even more interesting how companies made very smart decisions in changing that niche strategy over time. So as an example, a nylon, DuPont was very smart in choosing lady stockings as a type of product form for the nylon material, because they found out that silk stockings, the silk per kilo was the most expensive material, and if they would be able to introduce nylon in that way, they would improve their profit. So they found out we're going to have nylon stockings. And but they couldn't, because the material should have been so fine that they could weave it as if it was silk. So what they did is they decided then to make toothbrushes, because you have thick frets and they could sort of improve the production process. Now here you see such a sequence. It's like toothbrush, and then they tried to use it for clothing, which failed, by the way, and then they tried again. But in the end, they were always aiming for the lady stockings, which were then introduced in 1939, and it was an instantaneous hit. There were rows of women of kilometers waiting and to buy the first nylon stockings, and then the Second World War started, and then their nylon was very important for different reasons, of course, because a supply of silk from Japan was sort of stopped to the US, so you see the whole story unfolding then. But this is an example where you see a company deliberately took steps. So an advice for people that are going to introduce their technology in the market would be that be very careful that if you have in mind the main application for your new technology, don't aim for that from the beginning. So have a vision on the steps by which you need to complete the entire system of complementary products and services and all elements required, and think about niche strategies that you don't want to remain in. DuPont didn't want to remain in toothbrushes, we can expect, but they had a very clear vision on starting there in order to be able in the end to sell lady stockings. So that's maybe an advice. Don't think directly in terms of the hit that you're aiming for, but build it up gradually.